Welcome back. We'll start with one of the major topics for geography optional that talks about biogeographical regionalization. Now, this is a topic where you have one to two questions that are asked for each and every mains since last 10 years papers if you can evaluate. And there has been a kind of changing trend where new and new classifications are being included as a part of this. So, New Bijan's classification was a part of 2016 paper. So, that's very, very important that we cover all the major classifications that fall under this head. So, we would design our class in such a fashion that we would have four lectures on this. The first lecture that we will talk about today focuses on the general concept of biogeographical regionalization and the various major classifications. Then we would have two lectures, one on terrestrial plants and another on terrestrial animals, and finally another lecture on aquatic classification for plants and animals. So, let's start with the basics of biogeographical regionalization today. Now, when we talk about the basic of bioregional geographic regionalization, why it is there and why is it required? The first and the foremost thing is, whenever we are trying to understand any wildlife, be it flora or fauna, that is plant or animal life, we need to understand a kind of dynamics in the system, and that could be obtained only when we know the hierarchy in the system. So, the first basic idea of a biogeographical regionalization was that it was a kind of hierarchical system for classification. Under this hierarchical system, as you can see in the demonstration here, you have the lowermost layer that is seen. Let's call it as a kingdom. When we say kingdom, we primarily divide the kingdom into two. That's the plant kingdom or the animal kingdom. Above the kingdom, you have the another level which is known as the region. The next two region, you have the dominion. And finally, on the top of the dominion, you have the province and the district. So, these are the major divisions under which you could demarcate any biogeographical regionalization. So, as you can see here, let's talk about the lowest level of this pyramid. It includes all the animals. Next, on top of it, you include all the carnivorous animals. On top of it, you include all the kind of wild carnivorous animals, which can be in the form of wild boar or belonging to cat family. And then finally, you have on the top, you have a certain species which is specific to that region. So, this all started with D. Kendall, who in 1820 talked about the kingdom classification, and he explained that the kingdom has a kind of minimum amount of endemic species that are present in the region. So, these are some of the key aspects of the biogeographical regionalization. Another important thing, we can classify this under two heads. One is the zoogeographic and another is the phytogeographic. When we say zoogeographic, it talks exclusively about animals. When we say phytogeographic, it talks exclusively about plants. Now, in this lecture, we would focus on some of the major regional classifications. Let's first talk about the various regions of the world. To help understand the biogeographical regionalization, to simplify it, there have been three kingdoms under which it has been classified. So, that is Holarctic, Holotropical, and finally you have the Austral. Now, under Holarctic, you have the Nearctic and Palearctic region. Under the Holotropical, you have the Neotropical region, in the American region, in the African region you have the Ethiopian region, and the Asian region you have the Oriental region. Then under Austral you have Andes in South America. Then you have Cape region in Africa. You have Australia region, and finally you have Antarctica region. Now, all these regions or all these provinces are part of the main kingdoms that we have talked about. Within this, you have certain transition regions. So, let's talk about the first transition region, that is Mexican region. And this region lies between Nearctic and Neotropical. Then you have the Chinese region, which exists between Palearctic and Oriental region. You have the Sahara and Arabian region. which lies between the Ethiopia and the Oriental region. You have the Indo-Malaya region, which lies between Oriental and the Australian region. And finally, the last of it is South American region, which lies between Neotropical and Andes. So these are the five major transition regions. So we talked about the three major kingdoms, the subclassification for those kingdoms, and the five transition. So this is the broad framework where we divide the various animals and the plant life in this region. Now the next important thing was the first, the major natural regionalization was given by Wallace. We have talked about Wallace classification in a separate lecture. We have a link for that. You can just go on and refer that lecture. We'll have the link below. And then the next important things that we have already discussed is Ronald Good's classification that has covered the plant section and the Vivulus gene center. So these three we have already covered in a separate lecture. We would be talking about the remaining important classifications in these lectures. Now the next important thing that we said was, initially it was a hierarchical based system. It was based on intuition and later on based on the endemic species. Endemic species are those species which are native to a specific area. Now, how do we find resemblance between the animals, or we say these animals should be classified as Neo-Arctic, these animals should be classified as Holo-Arctic, and so on and so forth. So this seems to be very confusing and very kind of tricky question to answer. However, this is answered based on the concept of resemblance. So resemblance is the key idea to understand how do we classify plants or animals under different head. So under resemblance, you have two classifications. One is affinity and another is analogy. Under affinity, listen carefully, it includes resemblance in three things, that is form, habit, and structure. However, under analogy, it would include resemblance in form and habit, but no resemblance in structure. So that's the key aspect or the difference between the two types of resemblance based on which we classify the region. So you have either based on affinity or based on analogy. When we talk about the classification based on analogy, you have two further subgroups. One is teleological and the other is mimetic. Now when we talk about teleological classification, it includes modifying the existing habits. However, when we talk about the mimetic classification, it talks about the external, or I would say the kind of elusive characteristics that are found. So based on this, you try to classify the various plants and animals. Now, why this classification is beneficial? First of all, it would help us give a proper structure to understand. It will help us know a kind of arrangement. It would help condense the information and summarize the major facts. So the first thing that we would be discussing today is Hallridge's life zone classification. Now Hallridge talked about the concept of life zone, which was first given by Merriam in 1889, and Merriam, when trying to explain life zone, explained that life zone is a region where you have plants and animals which share unique characteristics, and that is what we call as life zone. When Hallridge tried to explain life zone, he tried to demarcate the region based on three factors. So the first factor that he considered was the potential evapotranspiration. The next was the annual rainfall, and the last was the humidity or the biotemperature. So these were the three key characteristics that he tried to include. While trying to include these three characteristics, his idea was to focus on latitude, that's 0 degree to 90 degree north and south. The next was altitude, the height above the sea level, and finally the humidity level. So these were the three factors that were primarily responsible for the basis of Hallred's classification, and based on that he tried to put in the various regions. So for example, the northern part of this triangle shows the desert areas, then you have the rainforest areas here, you have the scrublands and the dry regions that are woodlands that are found here. So based on the latitude, altitude and humidity, he tried to explain the life zones concept in the form of triangle. Now as we said, the Valley Wolf's Gene Center, Ronald Good's classification for plants and Wallace classification for animals, we have already covered in this lecture, so you can refer that. For today we would be moving forward with some other important classifications. So the next important classification that we would be taking today is MacArthur and Wilson's classification. Now MacArthur and Wilson's classification is unique. It is known as island geography, and under this concept they tried to explain a colonization of a new uninhabited land. That means a land which was not habited till now is now being habited by certain things, and that is what he tried to explain under his concept. Again, this classification does not include any kind of phylogenetic analysis. It's a kind of exclusive ecological study that he had done, and based on which he had given his primary focus on the number of species that are present in an area. So number of species that are present in the area are the primary focus. The next classification was by Rapoport. Rapoport's classification was later on so popular that Stevens gave his classification another name, which is known as Rapoport's rule. And this Rapoport rule talked about the latitudinal range of flora and fauna which are smaller at lower latitudes, and they increase as you go higher. So their range is smaller at lower latitudes. That was the key aspect that Stevens tried to explain, and based on this idea, Rapoport classified the region into three: holarctic, holotropical and holoantarctic. As we talked about the three kingdoms, the last one, which was known as Austral, has been named as holantarctic by Rapoport. Now as you would move further with various classifications, you would see the major broad classifications have remained the same, only the names have been changed, or there have been some area which have been incorporated and some area which have been removed. The next classification was Pelew's classification. Pelew's classification is again important. His classification was a kind of summation of both zoogeographic and phytogeographic analysis. So both for plants and for animals he tried to explain, and his classification was based on ordinal as well as statistical techniques. So that was again a key aspect of his classification. His classification was based on ordinal and statistical techniques, based on which he classified the following regions: the near Arctic region, which includes the North American region, the paleotropical region beyond the Asian and the northern parts of African region, you have neotropical, the South American region, Ethiopian, African region, Oriental, Asia, Australian region, the Australia and the smaller countries there, the Oceania region, which includes the countries of Oceania and Antarctic region. So that was the classification given by Pelew, and he classified the region broadly. He gave the 8 regions for classification. The next was the Muller's classification. Now Muller's classification talked about kind of numerous information which included, first of all, he classified 5 regions and few transition zones, which we would see, but his idea was based on center of dispersal. So as in contrast to the previous Pelew's model, which was based on statistical and ordinal analysis, his study was based on center of dispersal. That means there was a key species which was present at a point and it slowly and gradually dispersed around. So that was the key idea for Muller's classification. Muller classified into Holarctic, Neotropical, then you have Paleotropical, Australian and Archaeonotic. And this Archaeonotic classification was the important one, and this was the name for the Antarctica. So Muller changed the name from Antarctica to Archaeonotic. So that was one of the key aspects. Then he gave some important transition zones. Few of the important transition zones given by him were the Indonesian zone, the Central America zone, then you have the South American zone. So the southern part of South America was the key aspect, and the region of New Zealand. The last is Morone's classification that we would be covering today for the biogeographical regionalization. Now Morone's classification is important because he tried to put down the evolutionary changes. That means, let's talk about dinosaur, then how dinosaurs evolved from a kind of reptile to a link between the reptiles and the birds, that is Archaeopteryx, and so on and so forth. So it talked about a kind of evolutionary history moving from reptiles to birds and so on. So all the historical changes have been taken into consideration under Morone's classification. Morone's classification was based on component area matrix. So his technique was the component area matrix technique, and based on this technique he classified 3 kingdoms and 12 regions. The 3 kingdoms he classified were again the same: the Holarctic, the Holotropical, and the last one was from Austral, he called it Astral. So that was the only difference between the 3 kingdoms that he pronounced. Then in the Holarctic, he included the Nearctic and the Palearctic, as we saw in the classification. In the Holotropical, he included Neotropical, the African tropical region, the Oriental region and the Australotropical region. So all the Holotropical regions were called as tropical towards the end. So one was the Africotropical, Australotropical, Oriental as it is for Asia, and the Neotropical for South America. And finally, under the Astral region, he gave the maximum classification. So one was Andes towards the South America. Then you have the Archaeonotic, which was a part as given by Muller as well. And this talked about the Antarctic area. Then you had the Cape area from South Africa, you had the Neo-Guinean area from New Guinea region, then you had the Australotemperate region, and finally the New Zealandic region. So these were the 6 regions which were given under the Astral Kingdom as by Morone. So we have covered few of the major biogeographical regionalizations which are important. So the 2 things that are important to note in this session is, first of all, most of the biogeographical regionalizations were more or less the same. You had the names that had changed from one scholar to another scholar predominantly. The techniques that each of the scholar applied was different. And finally, the number of regions under which they divided, or the number of heads under which they divided, were different. In the next lecture, we will talk about the terrestrial plants and terrestrial animals. For the detailed information on all these classifications, we have included those in the recent version of our postal course. So this would include all the classifications, including the New Bijin classification that was asked in 2016. So you can definitely refer the postal course for the same. Have a good day ahead.